Let's start healing, everybody. I'm Adrianne Murchison, and welcome to a special segment of Ready and Real. We are really going through something traumatic right now, and this show is called Let's Start Healing. And I think of healing usually as something that I start doing after something has been resolved, not when I'm in the midst of it. But I think that because this is such a collective experience, that maybe we are helping each other, even though the trauma continues from one day to the next. I want to share something that I read that a lot of you probably already have seen, because there's so much going around on social media that we're absorbing. But Adana Garrett wrote something on LinkedIn on Friday. And for those who didn't see it, I want to read it. It's very brief, but she speaks for many people of color, I feel, in this statement that she wrote. She wrote, "Today would be a good day for you to check on your Black coworker, 'cause they need it. Despite what they may look like, we have learned to maneuver through trauma, from slavery ships to today, because that is in our DNA to move forward. Despite what they may say, as we have been taught to lower our voices, to not seem aggressive, as our passion can be threatening. Despite what they may look like, as we have been taught to always come in our Sunday best, to be taken seriously. Despite what you feel, we are not okay. And today would be a good day for you to check in on us. You want us to be okay." That was by Adana Garrett. And as I said, many probably saw that already, but I thought it was so powerful. And I was talking to a friend, and she said she didn't know what could happen to bring us through this. What she didn't know what could take place. And what I think would go a hell of a long way is for people who don't relate to this situation, people who are not of color, people who are white or another race, and this just doesn't land on them the way that it lands on us. If someone feels that way, what I think the first step is to have a willingness to care, to have a willingness to want to understand what the pain is and what it's about. And I think what I see always before this latest situation came up with George Floyd is that people don't care. They don't relate because they don't care. So if there's a willingness to want to know, well, you know, I really don't understand what you're going through. I don't know what that's like. I don't know what that pain is. I don't know what that fear is. I don't know what that anger is. Can you explain it to me? Can you tell me about it? Because I want to understand. If someone takes that approach, then things can change. We can move forward, but you have to care. If those other officers standing over George Floyd as he was being choked, if they cared, that wouldn't happen. They wouldn't have just stood there. And it's not just people who are not of color who don't care. We're not all the same. We're not all the same. And I don't speak for everybody by any means. I just speak to anybody who this resonates with. But when I woke up Friday morning, I went to my phone. You know, I'm looking through my phone, and eventually I come to CNN.com. And it's not even 9 o'clock Friday morning. And there were 6 stories relating to the same type of incident. There were 2 stories about Ahmaud Arbery and the McMichaels. There was the story about the woman in Central Park who called the police on the black man who was birdwatching. There was a story about Breonna Taylor. I'm forgetting because I don't think that added up to 6. But there were 6 stories. I was like, what the? I mean, that just speaks to the space that we are in. And this is not going to blow over. Change has got to take place. This is not going to blow over. It's just not. It's not. I was watching on Friday. I switched over to Fox, and Tucker Carlson was on with a man that I don't know his name. He was African American, and they seemed to agree with each other in their mindsets. And they were looking at some protests that were going on live, or they were from the night before, and they were just saying, those people don't care about people who get murdered. I think they made the point of so many people, poor people, were killed last year, and they didn't care about that, and those people. Well, those 2 people on Fox didn't care to understand. They did not care to understand. The next day, I was watching the Minnesota governor during a press conference, and he seems very compassionate. But when he was talking about the protests the night before on Friday night and all the destruction that was done, including here in Atlanta, but all over, and he excluded the people who caused that destruction. Even if they were interlopers or paid protesters, I don't care who they were. He said they don't care about George Floyd, or these aren't his exact words, but Eric Garner or Ahmaud Arbery. He said they don't care about any of this, any of these things. And he started talking about the hardworking people, you know, who own the businesses that had been destroyed or damaged. And he said, they don't care about that. And, you know, my thought is, why not speak to them in the camera? Why not say, did you know this business that was destroyed by the actions that you participated in? Do you know this, what these owners did to build up this business? Do you know who these owners are? Let me tell you about them. Let me tell you about the people who own the property that you destroyed. I mean, when I say you, I mean all of us. When we try to speak to everyone and not be as though we're all separated, because that is so damn easy to do. I'm as angry as anybody else, but it's very easy for me to attack, in my words, people who don't understand. They have to damn understand. We have to help them to understand if this is going to change. And I'm telling you, if you don't get it, don't think this is going away. Don't think this is going away, because the pain is so widespread. I think what is heartening through this is to see that there is such a rainbow of people who do care, who are standing up and saying, no, this isn't right. No, this can't continue. People of all colors in all persuasions. All faiths are doing that, but it's not enough. We need more. We need more people. We have to start caring. And if you want to take the position of, I just don't understand that, I don't get it, then what you're saying is you don't give a damn. And, you know, that's good to know. That's good to know if you don't give a damn. Because then we know where you stand. I mean, that's how I am. Then I know where you stand. I rather have directness than someone. I mean, and I'm not just talking about in this situation. I'm saying, period, in my life. I just prefer directness. I don't prefer vague actions and words. I'd rather just know where you stand and, okay, I can deal with that. If I know where you stand and you just don't give a damn, that actually, you know, is painful, but it also helps my healing. It helps me to move on. So I don't really know what more I can say at this moment, but my words for Let's Start Healing for our podcast is we have more in common than we think. And what we have in common can change the world. And that is the truth. You know, we all bleed the same. We all have people that we love. That officer, he has people that he loves. That man, I heard the nightclub owner where he was, he did security, that he and George Floyd happened to both work at. I don't know if they worked there at the same time. I'm thinking they did not. But she had characterized that officer as afraid. He was afraid of people of color. Now that's his problem, but he made his problem our problem. He made his problem George Floyd's problem. He made his problem George Floyd's family and loved ones problem. But we all have fears. We're all afraid of a lot of different things, but it's up to us to work on our fears, overcome our fears in a healthy way, and to care about each other. One last thing I want to say is several years ago in the 90s, I wrote a book about relationships between Black men and women, and I interviewed more than 50 men and women about their relationships, their experiences, how they move through the world as a Black man or as a Black woman, and how they bring that into their relationships. So I had the book self-published, and where I was working at a firm at the time, that most of the folks there were white, but there were plenty of people of color at the firm as well. But I self-published the book, and so I did a little fundraising campaign to see if I could get my friends and coworkers to contribute and help me to get this book published. So many did. And then when I got the book published, I gave them a copy of the book. Many of my coworkers who were white and Black, but I want to speak to my friends who I worked with who were white, and they started reading the book, and they were reading what Black men were saying that they experienced in the world. And several came back to me and said, I didn't know. I had no idea. You know, that was very powerful for me. But the thing is, they cared. That's the name of the game, I believe. Empathy. So that's it for Ready and Real today. As best we can, let's start healing.